In the year 5387, historical buildings from the early days of mankind are just a distant memory. Our databases have been corrupted, and so we must find all the old buildings and make a record of them. We've come to Polesworth as a part of our mission and wish to start with the oldest building in this fine village. There are many old buildings here, and our task won't be an easy one. Could this be the oldest building? A dovecote, I believe. Maybe it's this restored tithe barn. Or this old school. Wait, this looks very interesting. I think we may have found it. Let's go and look at the history of this place.
My name is Sister Editha, and I live here at the Abbey in Polesworth. We nuns lead a simple life, tending to the needy by providing bread and money and a place to rest. We look after the sick and injured, and our apothecary provides medicines to cure all ailments. Any weary traveller is welcomed and their needs tended to until they are fit to continue their journeys.
I was attacked in the woods and my horse ran away.
We try to help anyone who comes to the Abbey, rich and poor alike. We welcome strangers and local characters fallen on hard times. We never turn anyone away, even though our porter can sometimes be a little overzealous in the execution of his duties. Our sisterhood is a caring order, and we ensure the needy leave us with good, plain food in their bellies and hopefully God in their hearts. We also provide education for the children of the wealthy families. The gatehouse is the focus of the village, with many visitors passing through for prayer, medicine, and alms. This will be the life of the nuns at Polesworth Abbey for the next 200 years. Following an argument with the Pope, who would not grant him a divorce, Henry VIII broke away from the Catholic Church, and in 1531 declared himself leader of the Church of England. Polesworth Abbey looked certain to be saved from this fate following a payment to the crown of £50. However, the document remained unsigned, and in time, the letter arrived from Thomas Cromwell's office, which sealed the fate of the abbey.
Sister, this letter confirms the rumours that have spread across the shire. We are commanded by the king to leave here. The abbey is to be dissolved.
Are you sure, Mother Superior? Is there nothing we can do? Is there no higher authority that we can plead to?
I'm afraid not, sister. Our work here is done.
He decided to make changes to the monasteries, and so the Reformation began, and by 1540, they were all closed. And so, sadly, that is the end of the nuns' time here at Polesworth, and my part of the story is told. I will hand over now to Sir Francis Nethersole, who will continue with the gatehouse story.
The abbey land passed into the hands of the Goodyear family, who were great supporters of the literary arts and learnings. They continued with the school in the gatehouse, and it was at this school that a local farmer's son, Michael Drayton, was educated, and was to become a member of the largest literary circle to meet outside of London, which gathered here at Polesworth Abbey. The Polesworth circle included Ben Jonson, John Donne, Inigo Jones, Raphael Holinshed, and some say William Shakespeare, who may also have been educated in the gatehouse schoolroom. Their words still echo through the Polesworth air to this very day. Oh, but consider this small dust here running in the glass. No man is an island entire of itself. The song our shire of Warwick sounds revives old Arden's ancient bounds. Send not to know for whom the bell tolls, it tolls for thee. Clear anchor on whose silver-sanded shore.
For France, when we our sails advance, nor now to prove our chance.
Drayton was secretly in love with Anne Goodyear, a love that remained unrequited, but inspired his 64 sonnets entitled Ideas Mirror. The poets and thinkers gathered here to share ideas and merry times around the fireplace. I joined this great company when I became engaged to Lucy Goodyear, and in 1627 we were married in Polesworth Church.
Dearly beloved friends, we are gathered together here in the sight of God. I would like to ask Dr. John Donne to say a few words.
Few fast, few strive, few pray for the gift of continency, few are content with the incontinency which they hold.
Deus,
but times were often dangerous, and one could get caught up in political plots against the king. Whilst I was doing my utmost to serve the king, I became out of favour and was imprisoned in the Tower of London, which was later commuted to house arrest at my wife's inherited home. I was forced to find alternative activities to fill my time, and with the help of my wife, we set about making life easier for the people of Polswith. We built a school that was open to all the poor and rich alike, providing education. We also provided the tithe barn and kept the dovecot stocked with squab pigeons to provide food for the poor through the long, hard winters. So, life settled down and we lived in the house that Lucy's family had built, as did those who inherited it from us. This carried on until Victorian times, when the house was in need of great repairs. I'll hand you over now to Father Philip, who'll tell you more of the gatehouse story.
During the last century, the gatehouse has been used as a reading room, and during the Second World War, it was a home guard station.
So, Crabtree, do you think you could tell a Messerschmitt from a Spitfire?
Yes, Sarge, but I'm not sure about a Heinkel.
Well, keep studying them. You need to be able to spot one of theirs from one of ours.
Yes, Sarge.
In most recent years, it has been accommodation, and it was the many temporary modifications that were made in the 1960s that were stripped out to reveal the original structures that have now been fully restored. So here we are today in the restored gatehouse, and now you know some of the history of the people who lived here over the centuries. It's time now to start the tour. Thank you for your visit today, and I hope you enjoy the rest of your tour.